Hey guys, I gotta share this one. Look at this. Bill Cosby didn't rape me, but what he did has always given me the creeps. This is an article that was published in the Raw Story, dated November 19, 2014, by Dana Kennedy. The article goes on to state that I have zero evidence that Bill Cosby sexually assaulted or made unwanted sexual advances on anyone. Now, these are the words that are coming from another woman who has come forward to at least tell her story about a very bizarre encounter that she had when she went to interview Bill Cosby at the height of his career, when the TV show, The Cosby Show, was in its 8th season and was a phenomenal success around the world. So when she went to interview him, she's describing his disposition. She's describing what had happened to her. So listen here. She says, "But I do believe the growing number of women coming forward to say they were raped by Cosby or that he made unwanted sexual advances towards them. Here is why. Bill Cosby never hit on me and was never seductive in any way. But I remember how intimidating and menacing he was all the same. I met him when I was assigned to write a feature story on him for the Associated Press in February of 1992. He was at the peak of his powers when I was ushered into his dressing room at the Kaufman Astoria Studios in Queens. The groundbreaking Cosby Show, one of the most successful TV series of all time, was in its 8th and final season. The year before, this 54-year-old son of an alcoholic father who grew up in a North Philadelphia housing project had made $113 million, which was a lot of money back then. He didn't say hello. He had his game face on, or maybe that's his only face off camera. His first three words were, 'I don't pose,' meaning for photographs. There was no other kind of welcome." So in other words, when she walked in, he was defensive and let her know right off the bat that he was not going to pose for a photo op for the article that she was sent to write. She goes on to say, "I've interviewed hundreds of celebrities and other notables over the years, including such notoriously difficult people as Dennis Rodman and Mickey Rourke. The majority of interview subjects are remarkably professional and pleasant. I spent close to 4 hours in Jack Nicholson's home on Mahalit Drive when I was profiling him for the New York Times. Despite his longtime rep as a hopeless womanizer, which Angelica Hudson has just reminded us of again in her new book, Nicholson was a total gentleman. He rarely gives print interviews and admitted he felt that he had more control on television. Cosby told me the same thing, but whatever Nicholson's issues were with the media, he gave no attitude nor made any advances during our time together. However, as I wrote in my ensuing article about Bill Cosby, the tension in the air was remarkably thick, as Cosby immediately took control of our interview by treating me to a fairly hostile 14-minute discourse on why he distrusted the press." And so she goes on to talk about Cosby's attitude, and she said that it was especially bewildering because he usually got good press. He was for years one of the most beloved performers in show business. But Cosby goes on to retort, "Tell me what you want to ask and we'll see how it goes. He told me, speaking slowly and measuring his words, 'If it don't go well, I'll give you a piece of fruit.' Now keep that in mind. 'I'll give you an apple or a pear and you can be on your way.' That's what he said to her. He'll give her a piece of fruit if the interview don't go well. My questions apparently passed muster, although as I wrote, Cosby controls the interview by stretching each answer into a lengthy soliloquy." So she goes on to say the interview was so unusual and uncomfortable that it seeped into the article that she wrote. "It's hard to know how else I could have written it. The substance of what he said took a back seat to the atmosphere Cosby created for us He was a very scary guy. This is what she says. And she goes on to say, less than a week after the story was published, she received a package at AP's world headquarters, which was then at 30 Rockefeller Plaza. This is before 911. She says inside was a sheet of paper with three typed words that said, here's your apple. The signature in blank ink read, Bill Cosby. And wrapped in a paper towel was indeed an apple dried and withered. Now that is bizarre. That's very bizarre. And she goes on to say, I marveled at the time that a man in his position would go to the trouble of locating a dead apple, placing it in a paper towel, finding out the address of the Associated Press, and mailing it to me. Now, this may sound like nothing to most people, but for someone who has been accused by over 14 women of drugging and raping them, this fits a pattern of someone with some deep-set psychological control issues and even vengeance, because this is what that was. And this is why I have a problem with people sympathizing with Cosby's wife and yet condemning these women for waiting so long to come forward. They're not considering a lot of factors. But with Cosby's wife, I have a problem with. Why? Because the kind of character that Cosby is off camera, as manifested by what these women have reported, is just no way that the wife did not know. She may not have known about the rapes, but she knew about a lot of other serious defects in his character. She had to, as long as she was married to him. But she played the doting, loving, supportive, passive wife, his arm candy, immaculately dressed, professionally decored, and presented herself always on his arm when they were out in public. But behind the scenes, she had to have known some issues with him. A serial rapist, just as a serial killer, they have certain character defects, personality defects, control issues, issues with vengeance, issues with women. And all of this somewhere in that household had to manifest. How could she have not known? But anyway, for him to take the time, this was just a AP reporter. She was just doing an interview. But for him to take the time to send her a dead apple, for the most part, a dried up apple wrapped in a paper towel, this is ritualistic to me. It's very symbolic and ritualistic. And mail it to her to let her know he didn't like her interview. Not only is it immature, but it speaks of a deep-seated pathology. Something's wrong with him. And this is why, to me, this story is important. But she goes on to say, Bill Cosby may not be responding to the allegations against him, but I wish he'd tell me, amongst other things, where he even found an old withered apple. Where did he take the time to find it? Did he have them stored somewhere? I wonder, are others going to come forth and relate a similar experience? Did he keep a store of drying fruit with him at all times to send to errant reporters? Did he assign a flunky to get the apple, type out the letter, and bring it to him to sign, or did he do it himself? I wonder if I'll get anything in the mail this time. So her name is Dana Kennedy. She's an American journalist based in Paris, Nice, and New York City. And it goes on to state her writing background, her credibility. And she's not accusing him of rape, but she is recounting something that is important, and that's the psychological profile of Bill Cosby. So this, with the other allegations of the women who are coming forward, and I don't think they really want anything. A lot of people are bashing them and saying they want money. They went back for more. But you have to understand the times back then. In the 60s and the 70s, and even the early 80s, it was very difficult for women to report rape, let alone someone of Cosby's stature. You just didn't do that. That was a career killer, especially as big as Cosby was back then. And they may have been ambitious. Of course, that's what you do. You social network. Women are socialized to marry up. They're socialized to make connections like that, and it's usually through men. But you don't have to be a slut. But Cosby clearly had a fetish for a certain type of woman. Blonde, perhaps very young, and passive women. And had they rejected him or said anything, that would have been the end of their careers. He would have sold to it. And so this is one of the reasons these women probably didn't speak up. But what he did to them, how he degraded them and humiliated them, how he drugged them. Some went back. Women did that back then. They didn't even see it as rape because these type of things were considered a lot of men's privileges, especially wealthy men, such as Cosby, powerful men. They did these things. So you can morally condemn the women, but clearly they were deeply affected by it, and all they're doing is getting their story out. They feel they have an opportunity now to tell their story, and they're doing it. And so I think where there's smoke, there's fire. Some of them may have been irresponsible. I don't know. I'll leave that to the guys to judge. But where there's smoke, there is fire. 14 women is a lot, and it's something to consider, especially in light of another claim, but this is a psychological profile, so we're taking this to another level. I'll leave the link below. You can read it and you can decide for yourselves. Okay, thank you.